بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
A presentation of Quran Sunnah educational programs. Visit us online at www.qsep.com.
إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ وَرَأَيْتَ النَّاسَ يَدْخُلُونَ فِي دِينِ اللَّهِ أَفْوَاجًا فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ إِنَّهُ كَانَ تَوَّابًا.
My respectful brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is indeed a very sensitive time of the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is his last days in Medina and the days following his death. May peace and prayers be upon him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before his death in a few months, his beloved son Ibrahim, the son of Maria, the Copt, has died. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sad, as any father, for his son. He was about 15 months old when he died. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam afterwards sent the army of Usama ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu to fight the Romans in Sham. And Usama ibn Zayd was a very young companion, and he was very much beloved to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just like his father Zayd radiyallahu anhu was very much beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Usama was very young, so many hypocrites started as usual to spread rumors and say bad things about Usama radiyallahu anhu. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam insisted on making Usama the leader of that army, and he insisted on sending him to the Romans to fight them, even though he was very sick. And the sickness of the prophets and the pain which accompanies the sickness is many times as much as the regular people. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started to get sicker because of the effect of some poison that he was given by a Jewish woman. This poison's effect lasted for 1 year or more, until it led to the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in that time was showing signs of leaving. وإن سورة النصر إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. When this surah was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that was before his final sermon to the companions. Therefore, when he started his farewell sermon, he said, لعلي لا ألقاكم لعلي لا ألقاكم بعد هامي هذا. It might not be possible to meet with you after this year. Because he understood from this surah that his mission was accomplished and that he was about to leave the companions of the messenger, may Allah be pleased with them. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and some other companions understood from this surah this. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hinted to his death and he said, a slave of Allah, meaning himself, has been given the choice to stay or to meet his Lord. And this slave of Allah has chosen to meet with his Lord. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anh shouted in crying. And he said, we sacrifice ourselves for you, O Messenger of Allah. Our life is a sacrifice for you. Our father's life is a sacrifice for you. Our mother's lives is a sacrifice for you. So some companions wanted to quiet Abu Bakr. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, leave him. By Allah, everyone's favors could be repaid except the favors of Abu Bakr. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was hinting in those last days that Abu Bakr will be his successor, his khalif, because khalifa means successor. He made him the Amir of Hajj in the 9th year of Hijrah, which shows also the great position in knowledge that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had. He was the most knowledgeable after the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And days before his death, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered that Abu Bakr should be the leader in prayers. And 1 or 2 days before his death, a woman came to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking him for something, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her to come tomorrow, he said, because I am feeling very painful today. And she said, what if I don't see you tomorrow? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then come to Abu Bakr. If you don't see me, then come to Abu Bakr. Which means that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that Abu Bakr will be the leader after the Muslims, after his death for the Muslims. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a true hadith, اقتدوا بالذين من بعد أبي بكر وعمر. Follow the two after me, Abu Bakr and Umar. And also, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to write a will regarding the Khalifa after him. He said, bring me a piece of paper so that I write a will to the Khalifa after me. Who is the Khalifa? He was very sick and painful, and the companions, some of them said, let's bring the pen quickly, and some of them saying, be gentle with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is very sick, very painful, be gentle with him. don't rush him. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw this kind of argument, he said, there is no need to write. The Muslims will choose Abu Bakr anyway. أَبَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا أَبُو بَكْرٍ أو إِلَّا أَبَا بَكْرٍ, that Allah will choose Abu Bakr and the أَبَى اللَّهُ وَالْمُسْلِمُونَ and the Muslims will choose Abu Bakr. This was inspired by Allah to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. So those signs were very clear. And why did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not write the will? So that we have two choices to choose a khalif, not one choice. If he has written, then that will be the only choice, that the khalif is assigned by the khalif before him. But the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by this way, he made it two ways. One way is this, and the other way is shura, to make it consultation. And shura in Islam is not what they call nowadays voting and democracy and all that. Shura in Islam is that the scholars, the knowledgeable people, the high, يعني respected thinkers or people in that society, they should gather and consult amongst themselves and come to a decision for the leader. Not everyone. Not everyone. There is no such thing as what nowadays they call democracy, and everyone comes and puts his vote. There is no such thing in Islam. This is completely an innovation. It is completely resemblance of the Western so-called civilization. And the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has made for us two ways to choose the Khalif is a reply on some contemporary so-called Islamic thinkers who claim that the only way is Shura. And some of them go beyond this and claim that the only way is democracy and voting. Everyone votes. So this is a reply on them. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu himself, when he was a khalif, he did not make it shura after him. He assigned Umar. He assigned Umar. He said, Umar is the khalif after me. He did not make it shura. Why? Because he knew that Umar is next in line. And because he knew that some people might have been thinking that Umar radiallahu anhu is very tough, so they might dislike him And if they dislike him, they might not choose the right person. Umar is next in line, as the Prophet ﷺ said. And Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma says, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, we used to say that the Khalifa after the Messenger is Abu Bakr. And then Umar, and then Uthman radiallahu anhu, and then Ali radiallahu anhu, and Muhammad, the son of Ali radiallahu anhu, not from Fatima but from Al-Hanafiyya, another wife, Muhammad ibn Al-Hanafiyya. He said to his father Ali radiallahu anhu, Who did you think at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the Khalifa will be after Abu Bakr? So Ali, that the Khalifa will be after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Who do you think the Khalifa would be? Ali said Abu Bakr. They said, then who? He said, then Umar. So Muhammad says, I didn't want to ask him then who. I wanted to avoid that, so I told him, then you, my father? He said, no, I am only one of the Muslims. يعني علي رضي الله عنه knew that after Umar is Uthman. And this have been mentioned at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, while the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was alive, that the Khalifa after the Prophet is Abu Bakr. And then Umar, and then Uthman, رضي الله عنهم. And this is the Aqidah of Ahl al-Sunnah. All Ahl al-Sunnah agree on this. This sequence. Abu Bakr, then Umar, then Uthman, then Ali, رضي الله عنهم أجمعين. And Ali, رضي الله عنه, when he became the Khalifa of the Muslims, he stood on the minbar, and he said, by Allah, if I am informed about anyone who says I am better than Abu Bakr or Umar, I will whip him with the whip for 80 lashes. 80 lashes. I will whip him. He said, because this is a slander of Abu Bakr and Umar to say that I deserve to be a Khalifa before them. So this was the situation with the Khilafa.
وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلِ أَفَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا.
And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, the most reasonable companion who was standing very strong was Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Even Umar radiallahu anhu almost lost his mind when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died. He got very emotional and he started threatening the people. Anyone who says the Messenger has died, I will cut his neck. By Allah, he did not die. He just went to meet with his Lord like Musa did. And he will come back and he will cut the hands of those who say the Messenger died. He was speaking out of emotions. He couldn't help it. He was the most knowledgeable person after Abu Bakr, and he was the most faithful after Abu Bakr. And Fatima radiallahu anha, when she saw the companions burying the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she said, how could yourselves allow you to shed the dust on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She was also speaking out of emotion. This is something that one cannot help it at that time. Otherwise, she knows that her father is a human, and humans die. And when they die, they must be buried. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he died, it was the darkest day for the companions. Just like when he came to Medina, the companions considered it the most beautiful day. And they thought the Medina has lighted up with light. And when the day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, this was the darkest day in Medina. And Bilal radiallahu anhu, the muadhin of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, quit making adhan. He couldn't. And he asked permission from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to leave Medina altogether due to his emotions. And he went to Sham, Syria nowadays, or Palestine maybe. He went there. Then Umar radiallahu anhu, when he visited Sham, he asked him to make adhan. And when he made adhan, Umar cried and the companions cried because they remembered the days of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ.
And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, his funeral process, his washing and preparation and all that was made by his closest family, by Ali, Al-Abbas, the sons of Al-Abbas, and the sons of Ali, even though they were very young. Because this is the sunnah for the deceased, that his family take care of his washing and funeral. And now, alhamdulillah, it is easy. There is, yani, some people who are assigned by the government who do this. But the sunnah is that the closest are the ones who prepare the deceased. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died on Monday, the 12th of Rabi'ul Awwal. So actually, nowadays, those who claim to celebrate the Mawlid, they are celebrating the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because that's the day that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died. Monday, Rabi'ul Awwal, the 12th. The day he was born is not known. It's not known. It's not confirmed by authentic narrations. So they are celebrating an illusion, you see. And the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam were more loving for their Prophet than anyone else. And they did not celebrate the birth of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet did not tell them. Otherwise they would. And until 500 years after the death of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no one in the Muslim countries celebrated the so-called birth date of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one. The first ruler who ordered this was when the Fatimids were the rulers of Egypt. They ordered this celebration They said, since the Christians celebrate the birthday of Jesus, then our Prophet Muhammad is more worthy to make such a date for. Something from their mind, an innovation. That's why there is no one amongst the four imams who says that the celebration of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is favorable or is sunnah. No one. Not Imam Abu Hanifa, not Imam Malik, not Imam Shafi'i, not Imam Ahmad, no one. And until the year 500 and something of Hijra, no one knew such a thing in the Islamic country. There was no mentioning of such a thing. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died on Monday. He was washed and prepared on Tuesday, and he was buried and prayed upon by Wednesday, the third day. In the first day, Monday, when Abu Bakr radiallahu anh and Umar radiallahu anh were helping the family of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in whatever they needed, a news came to them that the Ansar in Medina, the companions in Medina called the Ansar, have gathered in a place called Saqifat Bani Sa'idah, and that they are in the process of choosing an emir, a khalif. Why did they rush for this? Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, he who dies without a bay'ah in his neck, without an oath of allegiance for a khalif in his neck, mata mitatan jahiliyah, he will die in a state of ignorance. Which means it's an obligation, it's a priority to assign a khalif immediately. So they gathered, Abu Bakr and Umar. As soon as they heard this, they rushed towards Saqifat Bani Sa'idah. Why? Because they were afraid that the Ansar might not choose the right person. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Al-A'immatu min Quraysh. As Sheikh Anwar, may Allah reward him, mentioned the hadith. The rulers, the imams, the khalifs are from Quraysh. This is the sunnah. This is the way to do it. That's why they rushed. They didn't want their brothers to choose other than from Quraysh. So when they came there, Abu Bakr gave a speech and he reminded them of this hadith. As soon as they heard it, they kept quiet. No more talk. No more suggestions. No more argument. Because the companions know the position of Sunnah, of the orders of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They stopped talking. They stopped arguing when Abu Bakr said this hadith, because they didn't know it. Because when Abu Bakr came to them, first he told them, the imams are from us, from Quraysh, and the ministers are from you. Then he mentioned the hadith, so they all kept quiet. Because they would never dare to act upon other than the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No room for opinions when the sunnah comes. When the saying of Allah and his Messenger comes, no room for opinions, No room for other rules. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَارَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِ. There is no choice for the faithful person, male or female. When the order of Allah or His Messenger comes, to choose something else, there is no choice. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتُ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by Himself, and this is very few in Quran, very few times when Allah swears by Himself. But this is very important. So Allah is swearing by Himself, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ, by your Lord. They will not be faithful until they make you, Muhammad, meaning the Sunnah, until they make you as the judge amongst them in all disputes, fima, in all disputes. And what else? Then, when they take the dispute to you, to the Book of Allah, and to the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا. When they see your rule, they should not find in their hearts any doubt about it, any dislike, any hatred. Doubting the rule of Allah is kufr. Disliking it is kufr. Hating it is the same, disliking it, or disbelieving in it. All these are kufr, takes someone out of Islam. If someone dislikes anything in this religion, knowing that it is from the religion, even if he practices it, he is not a Muslim. If he dislikes this Sharia for what it is. Sometimes one might like some effects, hard effects, like Allah said about jihad, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِتَالُ وَهُوَ كُرْهٌ لَكُمْ. There is some difficulty in jihad, pain. That is not kufr. That is something natural, you see. Fasting has some difficult effects on you, hunger, thirst, and things like that. So you might dislike those effects. This is not kufr, this is natural. But to claim that fasting is worthless, is of no use, is backwardness, this is kufr. This will take you out of Islam. So we have to be very careful, because a person can come out of Islam just like this, quickly. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a true hadith, a man would say a word. By that word, he will fall in the least, or in the lowest part of hellfire, while he is not paying attention to that statement. Some companions in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were Muslims, they were companions, but they were new Muslims. So they were joking on their way, but their joke was about other companions who were very much active in reciting Quran, memorizing Quran, studying Quran. So they were making jokes to cut the distance, you know, to fill the journey with some kind of amusement. They were only joking for amusement. They did not know that this joke is considered to be kufr. They did not know that. But what did Allah say about them? He said that you have become kafirs after you were Muslims. قَدْ كَفَرْتُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ. Do not apologize, he said. Why did they become kafirs? Because their mockery of the companions who are interested in memorizing Quran is a mockery of Quran itself. And that's why Allah says, قُلْ أَبِ اللَّهِ وَآيَاتِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. Where are you mocking Allah, His books, His messengers? And they were only mocking companions, but they were described as such. And when the companions decided on Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when the companions heard Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu say that Khalifas are from Quraysh, they all kept quiet. So Abu Bakr held the hand of Umar and he said, you are the Khalif. Umar said, no way. I would rather my head to be cut than be the Khalifa on people like you. You are the one. Give me your hand. So he gave the bay'ah to Abu Bakr, and the rest of the companions followed, including Ali radiallahu anhu. And then after burying the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they made the bay'ah again in Medina as a reassurance. They made the bay'ah in the masjid again. And Ali radiallahu anhu attended the bay'ah also. After 6 months, when Fatima radiallahu anha died after a long sickness, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave her the news before his death, he said, you will be the first one amongst my family to follow me. And she died 6 months after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Fatima radiallahu anha was a great, knowledgeable, pious woman. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam called her Sayyidat Nisa al-Alameen, the best of the women in the whole humans, the whole creatures. And he called Khadija Sayyidat Nisa al-Alameen, also her mother. So Fatima radiallahu anha, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, he left a land in Khaybar. She was a scholar, and she thought that this is her right to get this land, to inherit it. So she came to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and she reminded him of this. Abu Bakr gently reminded her of the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Inna ma'ashir al-anbiya la nuwarrith ma tarakna sadaqa. That all prophets don't leave inheritance. Whatever they leave is a charity for the Muslims. Fatima felt sad because she thought she was right in this. Not because Abu Bakr is preventing her from a land. A land to Fatima is worthless, is nothing. The whole dunya to Fatima is worthless. But the enemies of Allah try to make this as a matter of Fatima wanted the land and Abu Bakr didn't give it to her, and she was very sorry until she died from this sorrow. A'udhu billah. This is very ugly to say about Fatima. No, Fatima just felt a little bit sad because she thought her opinion was right, that she deserves this, and that the hadith that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu narrated might not apply to this situation. It might only apply to the money and things like that, not the land. So anyway, Fatima رضي الله عنها died after 6 months, and Ali رضي الله عنه was taking care of her during the time of her sickness, all the time. He was only going to make jama'ah prayer and come back. Not mixing with the Muslims, not as much as he can, he was in the house taking care of Fatima رضي الله عنها. Showing the sunnah of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, خيركم لأهله وأنا خيركم لأهلي. The best of you is the best for his wife, for his family. And I am the best for my wives, for my family. That's what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said. So Ali رضي الله عنه was keeping his service at home for Fatima. And this is what Uthman did when he married the two daughters of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They got sick and he was taking care of them until they died, both of them. So Ali رضي الله عنه came and reassured the bay'ah of Abu Bakr again after 6 months. Why? Because some of the hypocrites started to spread rumors that Ali is angry with the Khalif, and that's why he is not coming and mixing with the people except for the prayer, he comes and leaves. So to cut those talks, Ali رضي الله عنه came and gave bay'ah for the second or the third time for the Khalifa Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه. A great incident also is when Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه was assigned as the Khalif, he insisted on sending the army of Usama ibn Zayd to the Romans. Why? Because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was insisting on it before his death. So he kept insisting. And they told him, but Khalif, the Arabs have turned away from Islam. The Arabs that were living far away, not the ones in Medina, no. The ones who were living in the deserts and far away, they rejected Islam. Some of them rejected the zakat, charity. They said, when Muhammad was alive, we were giving it to him. Now we don't give it to anyone else. So they told him, how could you send the army to the Romans while we have this situation now? Those Arabs are turning away from Islam. He said, by Allah, I will not delay the plan of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani, no way. Don't try to make me change this, he said. This is the plan of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I will not delay it. And he sent Usama. And on the way, he was passing by those Arab tribes, and they were saying, Abu Bakr, if he is sending this much to fight the Romans, then he must have much, much more. So they got fear from Abu Bakr and the Khalif. This made fear in their hearts. And some of them returned back to Islam just because of this. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was merciful to the Muslims. The Romans backed down. They did not fight the army of Usama. They gave up and Usama came back victorious. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu had another plan. And that is to fight those who rejected Islam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من بدل دينه فاقتلوه. He who changes his religion from Islam, then you kill him. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu wanted to do this order of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And then when they said, when some companions, amongst them Umar, said, how do you fight Muslims? How do you fight someone who says, La ilaha illallah? So Abu Bakr gave them a very fundamental answer, very simple answer. He said, La ilaha illallah has rights. It's not a word. It has rights. And just like salat is one of the rights of La ilaha illallah, similarly zakat. And there is no distinction between salat and zakat. By Allah, I will fight those who refuse to give the zakat. So he fought them, and alhamdulillah, all of them came back to Islam and to give zakat. And things got better and stronger for the Muslims. They were new Muslims. Those who rejected Islam, they were new, very new, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he gave his farewell sermon, there was 114,000 Muslims or more. Just the year before that, there were only 1,500 Muslims, or less than that, less than 1,500 Muslims. So you could imagine why Allah called the treatment of Hudaybiyah to be al-fath, the conquer. Why? Because of this. Because when the Arabs heard that Quraysh, the highest tribe, is seeking peace with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they said Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam must be very strong. So the news spread like fire, and they all became, they came and gave an oath and became Muslims. In 1 year, the Muslims doubled almost 95 times. Doubled. 1 year. This is a great fatah. That's why whoever participated in that peace treaty are in paradise. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يدخل النار أحد ممن بايع تحت الشجرة. No one amongst those who gave me an oath under the tree will go to hellfire. All of them will go to paradise. And they were all the companions, except Uthman radiallahu anhu, who was sent in a mission by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Quraysh to negotiate something with them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put his hand for the hand of Uthman, and he said, this is the hand of Uthman, because they gave him an oath to die for Islam. And that treaty was called Al-Fath, the conquer. Even though that treaty included some hard conditions, which some companions found it very difficult to accept, Umar radiallahu anhu was arguing with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How could we accept this? How could we accept this? How could we accept this? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I am ordered by Allah, and Allah will not let me down. And they accepted humiliating conditions, but for the sake of the benefit of the Muslims. Like if a Muslim turns away from Islam and goes back to Quraysh, they don't have to bring him back. But when someone from Quraysh becomes a Muslim and he comes to the Prophet ﷺ, they have to send him back. They cannot accept him. They have to send him back. This was one of the conditions. And there were other conditions. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they refused that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. They told Ali, Wipe it out. Wipe out Messenger of Allah. Ali said, I don't wipe it out. They said, no, you wipe it. He said, no. The Prophet ﷺ gently wiped it out. He said, I know I am the Messenger of Allah. You know I am the Messenger of Allah. Let them say what they want. Then Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. They said, we know Bismillah. We don't know ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. These are names we don't have. They have ar-Rahim. They believe in Allah's mercy. But they just wanted to make things difficult, and maybe they didn't know ar-Rahman. So they said, wipe it out. So the Prophet ﷺ wiped it out. Despite all that, Allah called it al-Fath, the conquer. You see? And this shows that fighting is not a goal for itself. It's not a goal by itself. It's only a means to achieve the goodness of the Muslims. Therefore, any fight which doesn't lead to this is not jihad. It is ifsad, spoilage. It is evil. That's why in Mecca, when the Muslims were weak in the beginning of Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered, he said, كُفُّوا أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Tie your hands, don't fight. And establish your prayer. Because some youth wanted to fight at that time. Youth are very emotional. So they said, oh Messenger of Allah, let's fight them, let's do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, كُفُّوا أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةِ. Because you are weak. And even when the Prophet ﷺ went to Medina and he established a state, jihad was not made obligation until later on, years. And even when it was ordered, in parts, in degrees, in levels. First, permission to defend yourself. Next, fight those who are nearest to you. قاتلوا الذين يلونكم من الكفار. Then when the Muslims came in thousands and they had a big power, Allah revealed, اقتلوا المشركين كافة. Kill all the mushriks. Fight them. Bring them to Islam. Whether they like it or they don't, bring them. That's why the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, عجبت لقوم يقادون إلى الجنة بالسلاسل. I'm amazed. Some people are pulled by chains to paradise. You see? So, يعني those nowadays who consider themselves to be jihadis, unfortunately, they need to learn their religion. And the biggest sign of their ignorance is their hatred for the scholars. Why? Because the scholars are wise. They say, if we want to fight, let's see the situation. Are we able? Are we not? What are the advantages? What are the disadvantages? What is the outcome? What is this? What is that? Not just go and fight and lead to more chaos for Muslims, more evil for Muslims. This is not the way. Anyone who attributes this kind action to Islam, he is actually misunderstanding Islam altogether. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made it very clear. من قاتل لتكون كلمة الله العليا فهو في سبيل الله. He who fights in order to make the word of Allah uppermost, then he is in the path of Allah. And then amongst the most important thing that we should learn, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered his nation in the final ceremony to be good to the women. استوصوا بالنساء خيرا. Be good to your women. He made it part of his final sermon. And then he said, As-salat, as-salat. He emphasized prayers. And also before that, he gave a sermon. He said that those who live after me, they will see a lot of differences. So the only way is to stick to my sunnah and to the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa after me. Khulafa, all the companions are khalifs of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They inherited his knowledge. They are carriers of his knowledge. But especially the first four ones deserve this. And he emphasized on this and he said, stay away from every innovation because every innovation will lead to hellfire. And we saw how did the companions apply the orders of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how much they were concerned to do that. Abu Bakr, Usama, and the rest of the companions, the Ansar, and everyone. And this is, inshallah, as far as I can say in 2 minutes, as the brother. Actually, jihad is of two kinds in Islam. We have jihad al-talab, and that is the Muslims should go and spread Islam. They go to the enemy. And we have jihad al-daf', the defense jihad. Now, jihad al-daf' is when the enemies of Allah conquer a Muslim country, then everyone should stand up for the defense of the Muslim land. Even a woman can stand up if she can fight and go and fight the enemies to kick them out of the Muslim country. This is called jihad al-daf'. Except when the scholars decide that there will be more evil by doing this, it's better to surrender and not to fight, then it's not obligatory on them. So jihad actually in general is called fardu kifaya. Fardu kifaya means if some Muslims do the job, then the others will not be sinning by not joining. But actually our obligation nowadays is to prepare ourselves for jihad. Both prepare our faith and prepare materialistically as much as we can so that we don't depend on the enemies of Allah for our weapons or whatever. So our jihad nowadays is to prepare for jihad. That's our jihad. Now, the biggest proof that Islam did not only spread by sword, is that the largest Muslim countries nowadays existing, like Indonesia and other countries, they never saw any war. They became Muslims through the merchants who were going there and selling and buying and applying some morals of Islam and giving them da'wah to Islam. And also, when we fight some people, we cannot force them to become Muslims. We fight them to make way for us to tell them about Islam. And then if they were Jews and Christians, they are given a choice, either to become Muslims or to pay the jizya. So there is no force in Islam itself, because you cannot force anyone in Islam. Even if he tells you by his tongue that he's a Muslim and says La ilaha illallah, he can hide in his heart kufr and nifab. Now,
هذا من فضل ربي ليبلوني أأشكر أم أكفر ومن شكر فإنما يشكر لنفسه ومن كفر فإن ربي